Imagine a time when creative thought overflowed dreams, hopes, and ambitions. A time when making history was an everyday event and anything seemed possible. Imagine the beginning of television. It begins, like so many other adventures, with a man and a vision. Long ago, a young boy went to his father and described a wireless gadget, a radio. Very excited, the boy begged his father to get him one. Paul Crosley Jr. looked down at his son and said, "Sure," thinking it was no more than a toy. When Crosley learned of how expensive these radios were, he was shocked and set out to build the radio himself. Soon after his radio was complete, he tuned it to a radio signal from Pittsburgh. This intrigued Crosley, feeding his imagination with possibilities and many what-ifs. He then bought a 20-watt transmitter and started sending his own signal of recorded music over the air. What seemed to be just a hobby was growing into much more. Crosley's transmission was given the call letters 8XAA, and on March 22, 1922, became WLW, the first licensed radio station in Cincinnati, also giving birth to the Crosley Radio Corporation. WLW became a great success, reaching listeners all across the country, thus giving the name the nation's station. For several years, WLW transmitted with 500,000 watts of power, reaching people all over the world. In April 1937, the Crosley Radio Corporation began an effort of research, experimentation, and development completely devoted to try to making television a reality. They designed and built the equipment necessary to put a television signal over the air and applied for application for station construction. While waiting for approval, the 48th floor of the Carew Tower was leased out and later became the location for the first transmitter and studio in Cincinnati. The television station became known as W8XCT. Crosley's factories became increasingly busy, therefore he had to find another place for WLW. In 1942, Paul Crosley Jr. purchased the Elks Temple at 9th and Elm for $200,000. 2 years later, WLW moved into what is now known as Crosley Square. In 1945, the Crosley Radio Corporation became a subsidiary of the Aviation Corporation. That same year, the Aviation Corporation also purchased several manufacturing companies. By June of 1946, the war had ended, and W8XCT resumed its experiments. On June 6th, W8XCT sent out the first live pictures from the Carew Tower to Crosley Square. In 1947, the Aviation Corporation changed its name to the Avco Manufacturing Corporation. Crosley's company then became the Crosley Broadcasting Corporation, a wholly owned subsidiary. After many more experiments, the Crosley Broadcasting Corporation had learned much about the mystery of television. On July 31, 1947, W8XCT started a regular schedule of 1 hour a week on air. By the end of the year, W8XCT was on the air an average of 20 hours a week. Now that may not seem like a lot, but at the time there was less than 100 television sets in the entire city of Cincinnati.
When we started, there were very, very few television sets out there.
Just in the bars.
But the bars and in front of every electronics store, people would stand out on the sidewalks in the hundreds sometimes. If it was a boxing match or a popular show, and the proprietor would put a television set. In those days, the biggest set was probably about 10 inches. Mm-hmm. And you stood there and watched in fascination just to see that. In a very short time, of course, that changed.
On February 2nd, 1948, for a brief night, W8XCT became a commercial television station, WLWT, for the first sponsored television program in Cincinnati. Televised was an early session of the Golden Glove Boxing Tournament. The fight was sponsored by Wiedemann's Beer, making Wiedemann's the first television sponsor in Cincinnati. The next morning, WLWT became W8XCT once again. On February 9, 1948, W8XCT officially became WLWT Channel 4. On this date, the first department store-sponsored program in Ohio was Luncheon at the Sinton. The second sponsored show that day was the Kitchen Club.
But when we started, nobody knew anything about television. The clients and the people from the ad agency said, "Look, we don't know what's going on. Go out and ad-lib." So we ad-lib commercials.
Yeah.
Before 6 months later, they're all experts.
On February 13, 1948, the first Midwestern Hayride aired right here on WLWT. Little did producers know what a spectacular event this would be.
It was a fascinating time, a wonderful time to be in it. It permitted us to try anything we wanted to see if it would work on camera.
Well, almost.
Within reason. The rest of us left for the young people today to try. But they allowed us to try new ideas all the time to see how things were working. Things are pretty strict and regulated today. You know, you take somebody's shots, one to call, the guy sits on you. In those days, anything went. And it was really, really delightful to be able to explore this new medium of television.
On February 15th, 1948, WLWT opened the Mount Olympus studio.
At the start, nobody knew exactly what television was going to be like.
The original studio on the hill is so big. Why is it so tall? Only because the only guy had any other experience was Chester Herman, who worked in the St. Louis Opera House.
Yeah.
And they all visualized TV was going to be a stage.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody looked at it that way.
Mm-hmm. With a proscenium arch.
So yeah, that you just stuff, too. Until the very first show hit the air, you realized that was dumb as all hell.
Nobody knew what it
because
was
you realized
going to be.
You ain't going to show the audience what you don't want them to see.
In April 1948, WLWT signed the first NBC affiliate contract in the country, airing kinescope recordings of popular shows like Kukla, Fran, and Ollie. The recordings were obtained by pointing a kinescope film camera at a small television while it was picking up a signal of the shows being done live. When the recordings were complete, they were flown from New York City to Cincinnati. In 1949, a coaxial cable running from New York City to Cincinnati was finally connected. With the cable in place, Cincinnatians could watch their favorite network programs being done live with a cleaner and clearer picture. In addition to the network service, WLWT programmed approximately 40 hours of live studio performances each week. Coming up next, the 50s arrive here at WLWT as 50 Years on 5 continues.